This is the story of one of the greatest writers of all time. He was born in Russia approximately a century and a half ago. His name, Fyodor Dostoevsky. In 1821, a doctor, one Michael Dostoevsky, took up residence in a flat in Marinsky Hospital, which was situated on the outskirts of Moscow and catered for the poor people of the city. In November of that same year, Michael's son, Fyodor, was born. Michael Dostoevsky was an intolerant man. His wife and children lived in awe of him. The only pleasures the children ever experienced were to lose themselves in books and the occasional treat of being able to go horse riding on public holidays. When Fyodor was 12 years old, he and his elder brother were sent to boarding school. For the next 4 years, they only ever came home during the official school holidays. It therefore came as something of a surprise to both of them when, during term time, they were woken suddenly in the middle of the night. On arriving home, they discovered their mother dying. They were only just in time to say goodbye to her. That same night, she died of consumption. She was just 37 years old. And on that same night, something else died. Their childhood. It was gone forever. They had to leave Moscow, and with it their dreams of ever going to university. Having told his sons that they could no longer live in Moscow, Michael Dostoevsky took the boys to Petersburg, where Fyodor entered a military academy. Not so his brother, who had been told by his school doctor that he was unfit for military service. For 4 years, Fyodor trained at a huge palace, formerly the residence of the emperor, and which had been converted into barracks. Here he was taught topography, fortification, and the use of weapons on the field of battle. At the military academy, there were some good literature teachers, and Fyodor Dostoevsky made full use of his opportunities to attend the literary readings organized by these scholars. Also at the academy, there was a large and comprehensive library, and it was here that the young Dostoevsky read practically all the works of Goffman and Balzac. He also tried his hand at writing himself, creating historical dramas much in the style of Schiller and Pushkin. And in the winter they fought mock battles, training, training, and yet more training. In the evenings, Dostoevsky's thoughts would escape into a private world of his own, reading his books by candlelight and dreaming of a sparkling literary career and the fame that would accompany it. In my youth, I was overwhelmed by so many emotions that I was forced to keep them buried in my heart. In August 1841, Dostoevsky graduated as an officer in the Russian army. He rented a flat in the city and managed to survive on a small inheritance left to him by his father, who had recently died. In the autumn of 1844, Dostoevsky decided to resign his commission. He left the army and spent the following winter and spring in a small room on Vladimirsky Avenue, working on his novel, Poor People. At the same time, Grigorovich, a fellow student from his years in the military academy, had begun his career as an author. He was writing plays and as a consequence moved widely in literary circles. It was thanks to Grigorovich that a copy of Dostoevsky's novel found its way to Vasarion Belinsky, the most renowned and influential Russian critic of the time. Belinsky told him, "You will be a great writer." I left Belinsky's room in awe, and I felt with all my heart that something fantastic had happened, a turning point in my life. I had never been happier. The money Dostoevsky earned from his novel, Poor People, only just covered his debts. The book made him famous, but now he must repeat that success. However, his subsequent work did not bring him the same recognition or prosperity. His fame went out of the window as quickly as it had arrived. Now he was to experience one of the great truths of life, that poverty can drain the soul. I have now been writing for almost 3 years, and I am living in hell. I don't see life. It passes me by. I don't even have time to breathe. I exist hand in hand with poverty and endless work. How do I find time to rest? Dostoevsky would get up in the mornings and try to overcome the misery and sadness in his life by taking long walks through the city. These lonely walks were later to become part of his novel, White Nights. It was on one of these walks that he met Patrushevsky, a revolutionary socialist. On Fridays, Patrushevsky would hold social evenings at his home, where friends would gather to discuss art and politics. Dostoevsky became involved in these meetings. In 1848, the smell of rebellion was in the air. Dostoevsky and his newfound friends discussed the prospect of setting up a clandestine secret printing house through which they could air their revolutionary views. This was a mistake they were soon to regret. Nicholas I was terrorizing and oppressing the country, and there was a government informer in their midst. Everyone at the meeting was arrested and taken to the main prison, the Petropavlovskaya fortress. Fyodor Dostoevsky, 27 years old, retired officer of the Russian army, a frequent visitor to Petrushevsky's house, guilty of criminal activity. Dostoevsky wrote to his brother, "I was allowed to walk in the garden. There were 17 trees in it. That was a real pleasure for me. But I had nightmares. And in addition to that, the floor seemed to roll from side to side like being on board a ship." Today, 22nd of December, 1849, we were taken to Seminovsky Place. We had all been sentenced to death. They gave us the opportunity to kiss the cross. They broke a sword over our heads and dressed us in white in preparation for execution. Then three of the group were taken over to the pillars to be shot. I was in the second group. One more minute to live. Then they cancelled the order to shoot, untied those that had been taken to the pillars and brought them back to us. The Tsar's order taking mercy on us and sparing our lives was read out. I was sentenced to 4 years hard labor in the fortress, and after that I was to be returned to the army, not as an officer, but as the lowest of ranks. But I am not despairing. My life is not finished. I am surrounded by people, and the most important thing in life is to communicate with people, remain human, not to despair, and never to lose your ideas. I can still create images of the past and of the future. My body is covered with wounds, but I have a heart that still beats as strongly as ever. The same flesh and blood, and I can still love and suffer, take pity and remember. Goodbye, brother. Don't be sad. After 4 years, again a letter from Dostoevsky to his brother. All this time I've been locked away in the fortress, surrounded by high walls, only going out to work. I do not know what has happened to my soul, to my beliefs, to my mind, to my heart after all these years. It's impossible to explain, but I don't think the time has been wasted. Perhaps I don't know Russia very well, but I know the Russian people. I don't think I could have had a better opportunity to get to know them. My address, Semipalatinsk, 7th Siberian Linnean Battalion, rank common soldier. Ex-convict, now a soldier again. Fyodor Dostoevsky hoped that the new emperor, Nicholas II, would forgive him. But it was to be another year and a half before Dostoevsky was reinstated to the rank of officer. He was also given permission to marry Maria Dmitrievna, with whom he had fallen in love. Although their fate was to be exiled to the frozen bleakness of Siberia for a further 2.5 years, where they were forced to live, haunted by poverty and illness. But Dostoevsky and his wife Maria had two things in common that would see them through the ordeal. They were both unconventional and passionate. Living virtually at the end of the earth on the banks of the Irtysh River, Dostoevsky pleaded with his friends to persuade the government to free him from exile. At last, in June 1859, he was released and was able to retire from the army. With 10 years of humiliation and suffering behind him, Dostoevsky managed to borrow some money and move back to Petersburg and, more importantly, Russian literature. But the years of imprisonment and exile had taken their toll. He was no longer a revolutionary, but a freethinker who was to draw on his own harsh experiences rather than reason or logic. Immediately upon his return to Petersburg, he started to write. The action of the novel took place on the outskirts of a luxurious capital city that was engulfed and demoralized by poverty. The story was a melodrama full of mystery, adventure, and strange characters. It was a novel about the desperate struggle of decent, kind people against injustice. The novel, The Insulted and Injured, appeared in the magazine he published jointly with his brother. At the same time, he published another novel, The House of the Dead, a story about the hard labor and drudgery of life as a convict, the fatal strength of passion that can break a person's life, and the mysterious phenomena of good and evil which are so intertwined in human nature. Russia was overwhelmed by this book. Once again, his fame was established. Fyodor Dostoevsky was back. The euphoria was not to last. In 1864, one disaster struck after another. In April of that year, there was the death of his wife, Maria Dmitrievna, followed 3 months later by that of his brother. Then the government banned his magazine and closed it down. Dostoevsky tried to publish a new one, to be called Epoch, but the idea had to be abandoned through lack of funds. His brother had died heavily in debt. The pittance of 300 rubles in his brother's account barely paid for his funeral. Dostoevsky took on his shoulders the responsibility of looking after his brother's family, together with the burden of his debts of 25,000 rubles. But where was he to get the money? He had no prospects. Several times during that winter, he had to pawn his fur coat just to buy food. He was desperate. But out of desperation came determination. Constantly smoking strong cigarettes accompanied by equally strong black tea, Dostoevsky started to work. The novel was a psychological study about people like himself. Lonely, poor, unhappy outcasts in a large city. He described the way they lived, their houses and flats, long flights of dimly lit stairways, together with an analytical account of a murder that is central to the story. Dostoevsky used his own impoverished surroundings as the setting for his characters, the hero being a poverty-stricken young man who has been expelled from university and who decides to solve his problems by killing and robbing an old woman, a local moneylender. With topographic precision, Dostoevsky describes the way in which his hero, Raskolnikov, commits the crime as a philosophical experiment. Out of the ashes of desperation was born Crime and Punishment. In the novel, Raskolnikov reflects, "It was not the money I wanted. I needed to know something else. There was something else driving me on. I was eager to know whether I was a man or a mere insect, whether I would be able to take the money or not, whether I am an insect or not." When Raskolnikov leaves the old woman's house, he is thinking, "I didn't kill the old woman. I killed myself, not an old woman. The old woman was killed by the devil, not by me." Raskolnikov is tortured and depressed with fear and loneliness by his dreadful secret and the knowledge that he has made a terrible mistake. He walks along the embankment of Ekaterininsky Canal. He goes to the police station to make a confession. God's truth has overwhelmed him. He must confess to his crime because he would rather die as a convict where he would be with people again. By the autumn of 1866, the novel Crime and Punishment was virtually completed, but Dostoevsky's publishers were insisting that he honored his legal obligations to them. His contract specifically demanded that he must deliver yet another novel by November the 1st, and that was physically impossible in the time. To attempt a solution to the problem, Dostoevsky decided to dictate the novel and hired a stenographer. Anna Grigorievna Snitkina arrived on October the 4th. She was 19 years old with excellent shorthand qualifications. For the next 26 days, Dostoevsky dictated his new novel. It was to be called Gambler. It was a story about evil passions that drain the lifeblood out of a person, leaving him empty. On the 30th of October, Anna Grigorievna presented Dostoevsky with the completed novel of Gambler, which he had copied from her shorthand notes. That same day, Dostoevsky proposed to her. They were married in February 1867 in the temple of Troitsko-Izmailovsky. Dostoevsky borrowed some money against his next novel, and he and Anna traveled abroad. The trip was to last for 4 years. For some time, I had the idea of writing a novel about a beautiful, forceful man, but I was nervous about putting pen to paper, whether I would be able to make people understand. It is very difficult to bring it to life, and it is an infinite task because beauty is the ideal, and neither my country nor civilized Europe know what that ideal of beauty is. Instead, Dostoevsky decided to write a 19th century version of Don Quixote. He called his book The Idiot. It was so named because, for the most part, a selfless man is considered by society to be mad. And in the end, Don Quixote suffered and finally went mad because of his convictions. Nevertheless, Dostoevsky's life was still enlightened by the poetry of selfless love. It is not just chance that most of the events in his novel take place in the walkways of Pavlovsk Park, in the dim light of moonlit nights. There are, to this day, a few buildings still there in the park that give the distinct impression that they have been taken straight out of one of his novels. Dostoevsky had begun to write another novel while he was traveling abroad, a satirical novel called The Devils, which he completed on his return to Russia. Many people thought that he was mocking the ideals of his youth. However, the novel was approved by the government, whilst the revolutionaries of the day hated it. Nevertheless, everybody read it. The last few pages of The Devils were written in Staria Russa, a few miles away from Novgorod. From 1872, Dostoevsky was to spend his summers there writing. In In 1874, he also spent the winter months in Staria Russa, writing his novel, A Raw Youth, also meticulously keeping his diary up to date. More importantly, Staria Russa was to become Skotoprigonyevsk, the setting for Dostoevsky's last novel, The Brothers Karamazov. As in the past, he revealed the philosophical concept of the book within the framework of an actual environment, placing the characters into existing homes that were practically next door to his own. Even now, it is possible to find the house where Karamazov's old father was killed. And not far from there is the summer house where Dmitri Karamazov gave his famous monologue about the paradox of human nature, in which both good and evil are so inextricably entwined. Also to be found is the wine bar, where Ivan Karamazov argued with the devil about the impossibility of a harmonious world. Dostoevsky's flat in Staria Russa is now kept as a museum. According to Dostoevsky's letters and his friends' memories of him, the peace and tranquility he so yearned for all his life, he finally achieved as an old man. Now he found it easier to work. Anna Grigorievna was a good wife to him and an efficient housekeeper. They were no longer poor. They no longer lived under the cloud of being constantly in debt. Dostoevsky and Anna moved to a spacious and comfortable flat in Kuznichny Lane in Petersburg. Here in the evening, their friends would come to their home for dinners. Writers, actors, politicians. His children grew up and became firm friends with their father. Dostoevsky had kept all the notes his children had written to him when they were young. Dear father, I love you, Luba. Father, give me some sweets. Fyodor. At last he was settled and enjoying the comfortable family life he had always longed for. At last he was happy. In his book, The Brothers Karamazov, which he finished here in Petersburg, he described the decay of family relationships, moral degradation, and the distressing life of the poor and the weak. His heroes live in an unjust society, imposing on us the idea that there is no justice in the world. The Brothers Karamazov simply restated and reaffirmed Dostoevsky's success as a writer, a man who talked to the people about what was important to them. On the 28th of January, 1881, at 8:38 in the evening, Fyodor Dostoevsky, aged 59, sitting on the sofa in his office, died. Artist and philosopher, Dostoevsky's novels took pride of place among the works of Cervantes, Tolstoy, and Shakespeare.